mighty God. We worship you, mighty God. We worship you, mighty, 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 mighty God. We worship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, God, I take it. Thank you. Hallelujah. I got something I got to tell you this morning. Yes, he does. Because he can't lie. the blood.
Yes.
And therefore nothing can cross that bloodline.
Yes.
I'm on the right side of the bloodline. Yes. And once the blood has been drawn in the sand, you can't cross the bloodline. Because I'm on the good side of kid. The Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And whosoever believe in him shall not
perish.
Perish means something that's not killed. Something that goes back.
Uh-huh.
That's what it means. But he said, I shall not. Shall not perish. I shall not perish. That means I'm kept. A refrigerator keeps stuff.
Yeah.
If you don't, if it's nines and dollars, now I'm perished, but it's going to go back. Am I right? But he said, and ye shall not perish.
Yeah.
That means you won't go back.
Right.
That means you're going to be kept. I got you.
Right.
I got you.
Right.
I got you.
Yes.
I got you.
Yes.
When you feel like you can't take no more, I got you.
Yes.
I got you.
Yes.
I can't take it, but I got you. You don't get this here. I got you.
Yes.
I got you.
Yes.
He said he'll keep.
Yes.
When you get to the point you feel you can't take no more, remember that little song, Just Another Day.
Yes.
See, just that the Lord has kept me.
Yes.
When I think about everything that's happened this year, just another day.
Come on.
That the Lord has kept me.
Yeah.
Not only does he keep me, why does he keep me from all dangers?
Yeah.
Seen and unseen, as they say.
Yeah.
He kept me from everything I can see and those that I could. He kept me from all dangers. Not only did he keep me from it, but he kept my mind.
Come on.
Yeah. Oh my God, he kept my mind.
Yeah.
Yeah, I used to work in a mental institution where people go crazy every day.
Uh-huh.
But oh, he kept my mind. Even in the midst of circumstances and situations where I should have been crazy, God kept my mind.
Yes.
Hey, when some people thought I was going crazy, he kept my mind.
Yes.
Oh, why? Because I kept it on Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Yeah, body, regular repayment, but he kept my mind.
Yes.
Hey, God, he kept my mind.
Yes.
He kept my mind.
Yes.
He kept my mind. Yes. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Make this confession with me.
Just trust. Give him your burden.
Yes.
He'll take them. He'll take them.
Yes.
We prayed back in the room when we prayed for transformation. I don't know if pastor's preaching on that or not, but it takes transformation. It takes a making up of your mind.
Right, exactly.
And because God, you know the promises that He made you.
Yes.
You know the promises that He made you.
Yeah.
You know. You read your Bible and tell you. But you also know those deep inner things.
Yes.
Those secret things.
Yes.
And you know when God speaks to you. And He promises you things. She said, I was kept. My family is kept.
Yes.
My finances are kept.
Yes.
My health is kept.
Yes.
Do our promises to God stand true? Because there is a reciprocity thing that goes on. Your faith is that jump start to God's push and His action. So there's things you gotta do. You gotta work your faith. You gotta do what is needed to do so that you can get where you need to go.
Yes.
What God has for you is for you. It is for you.
Amen.
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 Amen. He kept us.
Yes.
He's keeping us.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Yes.
Don't run. Don't hide.
Things were dark.
Stand tall.
Yes.
Things look rough and bleak. Why is it always when things start going down? Is not come to church.
That's right.
I ain't going to church today. I don't feel all this.
Yeah.
You want to blame God or just be mad at a woman.
Right.
And you just disappear.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's like, oh, I'm sick. I'm like, I ain't going to the hospital.
That's
I ain't going to the doctor.
Right.
I ain't taking no medicine. I don't want to get better.
Right.
Holding on to God because He's holding on to you.
Amen.
Right. Sometimes this is how we treat God.
Yep.
This is how we treat God. Let's transform and turn around. Let's transform and turn around. Thank you, Jesus. God, I'm ready. I'm willing. I'm available. I want everything that you have.
Yes.
Everything. That abundant life. I want it. Every piece. I am a child of the living God. I want it all, but I also know that I have to do what I need to do.
Yes.
Sometimes it doesn't feel good. Sometimes we got to leave those friends that we hang around with. Sometimes we have to elevate our thinking.
Exactly.
Sometimes we have to read our Bible and we have to pray.
Yes.
Sometimes we have to come out of ourselves and relate to other people. That you are the only Bible some folks are going to read.
You better say that.
Amen.
Now. That's what's
real. Amen.
Right.
Let them read it right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh.
Thank you. Oh! Everything you came in with, everything that burdened you down, just let it flow out to Jesus.
Thank you for your presence, God. Thank you for your faithfulness to always show up and show up on time. Amen. I'm not going to read the scripture right off, so you all may have your seats. I'm going to talk to you just for a second here. One thing that I think I forgot to put on our electronic announcements. And by the way, if you go to the Bible.com app on your phone, you can find us, Agape Empowerment Live. You can click on that, and it will take you to an online version of our sermon. It will give you the scriptural references, and it also will have a reading plan for the week that you may be interested in. You can also take electronic notes through that system if you save the event. Those notes will be available to you for later. You can refer back to them. Back to what I was saying, the announcements are also on that Bible app. And so one of the announcements that I failed to put on there is that next Sunday, which is Christmas Day, amen, we will be wearing agape colors, which are red, black, and white, because we want to take an agape photo. We want to take a group photograph. And so please wear your red, black, and white. If you don't have red, black, and white, wear one of the three colors. Wear all black if you need to, or black and white, or however you can do it. Red, black, and white. Nothing in particular special. As far as just wear those colors, so we all in a color scheme, amen. All right, and we're gonna take a group photo directly after church on that day. So look cute, amen. Look cute and or handsome, however you. I know I'm leaving folks out, but look handsome, look cute, however, and come on to church, and we're gonna have a good time in the Lord, and we are going to take a group photo, amen. All right. You know, so we're going to go into the sermon, basically, and I'm not going to talk long today. I want to kind of get in here, get what I have to say out, and then we're going to dismiss. Amen. I talk a lot about observing the holy days of God. You all have heard me talk about this for years. You've been a part of the church for years. You've heard me talk about it for years. If you've just now come in, you probably have heard at least one sermon where I have talked about the holy days of God. And what I mean by that, even a few months ago, I preached a sermon, and I pointed out that in the book of Leviticus, Leviticus, the 23rd chapter to be exact, God designates there are certain holy days, holidays, if you will, for the people to celebrate, and that those holy days were supposed to be for all generations. Like he says, a lasting ordinance for all generations. Now, if you know the Bible like I know the Bible, I know that we are engrafted into that all generations, because Jesus Christ, as part of the seed of Abraham, who was the one that would redeem all of mankind, he has literally, by his blood, we have been adopted into Abraham's family of faith. So although we may not be born Jewish or through that lineage, Jesus' blood having covered us if we are Christian, we are engrafted in, and that's why we can call Abraham the father of our faith as well. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so as Abraham's offspring, that's who we are included in that through the blood of Jesus. As Abraham's offspring, we too should pay attention to what Leviticus 23 has to say about these holy days that God has given us. Just like we should pay attention to the Sabbath as well. God gave these things to us as for us to celebrate. God wants us to have fun, y'all. Did y'all know that?
Yes.
God really does. God wants us to have fun. That's what the holy days are. They're about really two or three main points. The first point is to pass on to the younger generations the stories that they need to know. The things that God has done, the miracles that God did for their ancestors. Because, and we do the same thing in our own households. How many people have a family story, a great aunt or uncle or grandmother or somebody, and the story has passed down and you know it because great uncle so-and-so did something great, and so now that's part of your lineage. That's the bloodline that you come from, and you know that story because it's been passed down to you. Am I the only one that got a great whoever? I know for a fact my great-grandfather was in the army, and my mother and my grandmother bragged about that thing because he rose the ranks in the army as a black man when it was not very easy for black people to actually advance in the army. My grandfather did. He advanced very, and I've seen some of his certificates and the things that he accomplished, and we're proud of that thing. And me as the granddaughter, I'm proud. I'm like, yeah, my granddaddy did something. You know, I'm proud of him and the legacy that he left. I know that's the blood that flows through my body. And so if he can do it, then so can I can do something great as well. That's the reason we tell our children stories. That's the reason you know about a grandparent or a great aunt or somebody that did something great, because that's the blood that flows through your veins. You should be proud of that. And if great uncle so-and-so could do it, so can you, right? Well, that's the same thing God wants his people to know. I've done great things for the people in the past. For your ancestors, I'll do great things for you. So he wants us to pass down the stories. The second portion of the holy days is God literally wants us to have a good time. How do I know that? Because on pretty much all of the holy days, with the exception of one, God calls for the people to literally have a party.
Yep, right.
He said, celebrate this day. This is the day when we do it, when we celebrate Passover. This is the day that the spirit of the destroying spirit passed over your ancestors and spared y'all. Party! That's basically what he says. Don't want to even get into Purim. Purim is the celebration of when Esther, in the Bible, when Esther was chosen out of her people to spare them, and I'll tell the story later. But in any case, the whole Purim holiday is nothing but a big old party. Food, party, and drinks. That's all it is. That's all Purim is. Because God wants us as his people to have a good time.
Amen.
To like what we are living, like the life that we are living. And so I know somebody probably read through Leviticus 23 and they know what I'm about to say, because I'm about to say the next holiday that's coming up is called Hanukkah. If you've never heard of Hanukkah or any other Jewish holiday, you've heard of Hanukkah. Everybody in here has heard of Hanukkah. That's one of the main, I won't say main Jewish holidays because it's not, but it is the most popular Jewish holiday. And somebody read through Leviticus 23 and is probably saying right now, Pastor, you done mentioned Purim, you done mentioned Hanukkah. Neither one of them designated in Leviticus 23. And so you are absolutely right. Hanukkah is not in our Bible. I will give you that. It's not in the Old Testament. And there is no mention of Hanukkah at all throughout the entire Old Testament. However, the story of Hanukkah having not been told is mentioned in the New Testament. So I want to read that for you. John chapter 10, 22 to 23. Because I don't want nobody leaving out of here. I don't know what Pastor was preaching about. It ain't even in our Bible. I'm going to justify what I'm about to talk about today. I'm going to justify by using John 10, 22 to 23. I don't believe in preaching a sermon without going to the Word of God to justify and to solidify what I talk about. John 10, 22 to 23 reads, "Now it was the Feast of Dedication in Jerusalem, and it was winter. And Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch. That's it. The word Hanukkah is derived from the Hebrew word for dedication. And so we can actually translate it into dedication. Hanukkah is, in fact, the feast of dedication. And we find Jesus has traveled to Jerusalem for Hanukkah in John chapter 10. When people ask me why I celebrate Hanukkah, and just so you all know, Pastor celebrates Hanukkah, it's because my Lord celebrated Hanukkah, and there's a very real miracle that happened that I choose to commemorate. And I'm going to explain to you why today. And you may, once I'm done, decide that it's something that you want to commemorate. You may not commemorate it like I commemorate it, or even want to call it Hanukkah, but I promise you that if you listen, then you will understand what I'm trying to get at, and that thing is going to seep into your spirit the way it sunk into mine, and you are going to want to commemorate in some way, shape, or form. Let me start by just teaching you, if I can, the story of Hanukkah. Is that all right? Okay, it happened around 200 years before Jesus Christ was born. That's why it's not in our Bible. Our Bibles are designated into two separate, the New Testament and the Old Testament. You know that, right? And between when Malachi cuts off in the Old Testament and when the New Testament starts up, there's like about, what, like 600 years or so between. That's called the intertestamental period. And so in that time, it's not like God just stopped doing stuff. You know, it's not like God took a nap between that time. God didn't just get silent. Stuff happened, but it did not make it into when the Bible books were put into the Bible. It did not make it into the canonization of the Bible. We call that canonization, the picking of certain books and putting them into what we call the Bible now. Understand that the Bible that you are holding, if you have a physical Bible, that's made up of 66 different books. It's not all one big document. There's 66 different documents that they put together in a certain order so that we could have the story of God, basically, all the way through from Genesis to Revelation. So you're looking at 66 different books. And so the certain books did not make it in. There's a lot of manuscripts that were written, a lot of things that were talked about, written down, documented. And one of those is called the Book of Maccabees. Yep. The Book of Maccabees is where you will find the story of Hanukkah. It did not make it into our biblical canon for one reason or another. That's a whole nother debate on why it didn't make it in. Let's just say God didn't want it in there. All right? That's how we're going to put it. God didn't want Maccabees for some reason. However, we do find Jesus knows about the story, and so it can make it seem that that gives me the idea that there's some validity in the story of Maccabees, in Maccabees. What happened was the Syrian Greek nation had taken over the Jewish nation, the nation of Israel. And so the Jewish people were being oppressed under the Syrian Greeks, all right? And so the Syrian king wanted the Jews to stop worshiping God and to worship the Greek gods. Now, y'all think that worked?
Nope.
No, we've seen story after story where there's been a Babylonian king or somebody that wanted them to bow down to somebody else, and they didn't. And so some of them did, be honest with you. There's always a few that's going to do whatever the rest of the people are doing. Some of them did. They started, doing the Greek thing. But there was one guy by the name of Judah Maccabee. Mm-hmm. And Judah Maccabee said, we are Jewish. We are Hebrew. We belong to the Most High God. Yahweh is our God. Yahweh is our King. We will not bow down to these Greek gods. Now, they had already pretty much destroyed everything that had anything to do with Judaism. And so the temple, which you know is the center of everything. Everybody know about the temple? The temple was where God's presence literally resided.
That's right.
God's presence, the temple was made up of four different areas. You had the outer court, which was the Gentile court. You had the inner court, which belonged to the Jews. Then you had the holy place, where only your priests could go. And then inside the holy place, you had the holy of holies behind the veil, which only one priest was allowed to go to so they could make a sacrifice one time a year. And when they went that one time a year behind the veil, when they went, they right standing with God, they would fall out dead, and they needed a way to get the body back. So they tied a rope around them and told them, go on back there to make the sacrifice.
That's right.
Because that is where the Ark of the Covenant was, and that's literally where God's presence lived. Well, the Greeks came in, the Syrians came and destroyed everything, just tore up everything. Y'all ever had folk come into your house and just tear down everything?
What?
You let them into the guest room, and when you come back, bed sheets is everywhere and stuff just look a mess. How you get a ring around the tub you was there for one night? You know what I'm saying? Like, come on. That's how they left the temple. Dirty. Just dirty. But one of the worst things that they did was they extinguished. They took the light out of the temple. They extinguished the menorah. So the menorah was supposed to always be lit. Y'all ever been down to the courthouse down here on Montgomery and seen that light, that fire that's always burning? That's how the menorah was supposed to be. And the reason was because as long as the menorah was lit, that meant that the presence of God was there. And so that menorah stayed lit because it burned oil all day and all night. And it was the priest's duty to keep it filled with oil. Well, the Greeks came in and they just let it go out. They extinguished the light and the thing was just dark and the menorah wasn't lit. So which meant symbolically that the presence of God had literally left. And so when Judah Maccabee led the rebellion and they end up fighting and God helped them win the war, because understand, we got some, you know, a couple of Jewish folk that's going to fight against a huge Syrian Greek army. There was no way they should have won, but God helped them in their battle and they end up winning. And so the first thing that they decided to do was to go in and clean up, even though the temple had been destroyed. Amen.
Amen.
How many people know when you allow the wrong people to occupy your space,
right,
they have a way of extinguishing your light, don't they?
Yeah.
And so that light was dead. That light was gone. And so they go in and they say, well, the first thing we have to do is we have to clean up the temple. That's the main space. That's God's house. We got to clean the temple. We got to put the menorah back on. We got to put the light back in. And we got to get God's presence back into our midst. And so that's what they did. But when they went to go and light the menorah, they found that they only had one jug of oil. And one jug of oil was only enough to light the menorah for one day. Well, it takes 8 days to make oil. And so they're like, well, what do we do? Do we light the menorah, let God's presence be here for only one day, only for it to go out? Or do we wait 8 days and then dedicate the temple? Well, they wasn't going to wait for God's presence. How many people know that you shouldn't wait on God's presence? See, some of us, we like to wait for the perfect moment to give our life to Christ. We want to wait for the perfect moment to come down to the altar. We got to wait for everything to be in just the right order before we say that we're going to follow Jesus or we're going to dedicate ourselves to the Lord. You ain't got to wait for that, because if you wait too long, then the ship will sail and you'll miss your opportunity. And before you know it, time has run out. And they said, we're not going to wait 8 days just to make some more oil. We're going to light it with one jug and believe that God will keep it lit until we're able to come up with some more oil. And that's exactly what they did. They lit it for, and it had 1 day's worth of oil, but it burned all 8 days, enough until they were able to make some more oil. See, when I look at that story, I see something in it. See, life has a way of beating us up sometimes, doesn't it? But we serve a God that is faithful to help us fight every battle and to win every war.
Come on.
See, I look at this story and I think of my own life and I see my life in it. The fact that the Bible declares in 1 Corinthians 6:19 that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, that means that I am the temple of the Holy Spirit, and the light that's within me is the light of God. And if I allow the world to desecrate me, and sometimes that light gets a little bit dim, and at certain points in my life that light has literally been extinguished, and you let the wrong folks in, sometimes they just tear everything up. But it tells me that since I fought a good fight and God has provided me to be victorious over my enemies, I got one last thing to do, which is to clean house and to rededicate this temple back to God. Resources to actually do what God has told me to do. Don't worry about your resources. Let God handle the resources. You just do it with what little bit that you do have, because God will make it so menorah burn for 8 days, God will make it so that you will have the energy to last all the way through until you're able to come up with some more. See, oil is a process. The oil of God, see, when we talk about the oil, we talk about the anointing. The oil of God is a process. You can't just conjure up, let me get a little oil, God, and then they fall down on you. See, you got to have made a process to get that oil. To continue to burn.
Yes. Come on. Yes.
There's a process in the oil.
Oh, yes, yes.
And I might not be perfect, but God, I'm willing.
Amen.
I may not have every resource, but God, I'm determined.
Yes.
And I'm going to work on the oil, God. See, because when you give your life to God, when you say, I'm going to get things straight, you got to work on the process for the oil. See, they didn't just say, oh, look, there's one jug. Well, let's see how long God will keep that burning. You know, they didn't say, see, that's what some of us do. We say, well, I got a little bit, God, and we light up on Sunday morning, and then we say, well, let's see how long God will keep that going. And then by the end of the week, we dead again, see.
Right.
See, God is expecting that when you come in on a Sunday morning, you got that little bit, and it ignites, and it's lit up. God is expecting that you start the process for making oil after that, because then it's on you.
It's on you.
Then it's on you.
Yes.
There's a process to the oil.
Amen.
There's a process. Jacqueline Carr, I love, what's her name? Jacqueline Carr, I believe it is. She said that there's a process. She said that there's got to be the breaking and the crushing. And say, I like that song because if it had not been for God breaking me, come on, somebody from last Sunday that was here, then the oil never would have flown out of me. See, you can't get oil without actually crushing down on the olive. See, the olive must be crushed in order for the oil to come out. And so I'm thanking God for the times that the world has crushed me, because it was in the crushing process, it was in the breaking process, it was in the destroying process that God was able to get something out of me, to press something out of me. I love when I heard Juanita Bynum, she said that only a pastor, and your pastor, not any pastor, but only your pastor knows how to get the oil out of you. She said something like this, and I'm paraphrasing, but she said, your pastor, you'll get up and preach a sermon or sing a song, and somebody else will glorify you, but your pastor will criticize you, and they will crush you. The thing is this, when I was coming up in the ministry, I had wonderful pastors that knew how to crush me. They weren't my friends, and so I would preach a sermon, or I would sing a song, and oh, it would be all right, or it would be good, but they knew how to critique me in the right manner, and it didn't necessarily feel good or feel like they weren't my cheerleader, see what I'm saying? But they tell me, you shouldn't have preached that long, or you should have preached a little bit longer, or where did you get that scriptural reference from? Or you know that didn't make no sense when you said that, and you need to slow down, or you need to speed up. You were boring at a certain point, or you lost the people at a certain point. See, you can't have the yes man in your corner and expect the oil to flow from you. You got to be willing to have somebody and submit to somebody that's going to crush you, that's going to say, no, that was not perfect. It was all right, but it wasn't perfect. You can do better. I expect more from you. How many hours did you spend researching and studying for that? Because it don't seem like you studied much at all. You got to have somebody like that critiquing you. The problem is, some of us don't like to be critiqued.
Come on.
Exactly.
We don't like the oil. We like the oil, but we don't like the process.
Right.
How is she going to tell me that I ain't studied?
Mm-hmm.
Well, did you?
Amen.
Well, no, but how is she going to tell me that I didn't study? See, there's a process for the oil. But the oil is what ignites God inside of you. If you are the temple of the Holy Spirit, which you are, that means that God's light should be burning inside of you. See, that's what Hanukkah means to me. It was a rededication of the temple many, many years ago. Jesus celebrated it, but now I'm bringing it to life. I'm making it applicable to me. Because I am the temple. You are the temple.
That's right.
Of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And if you are in a place, as all of us have been at one time, but you are in a place in your life where you're saying, Pastor, I have been ransacked. I've won my battle, but I got one last thing to do. I got to clean house, and I want to be rededicated. If that's you today, I told you I won't be up here long. I want to open up the floor right now. Because if that's you today, I want to pray with you. If you need to rededicate your temple, if you've allowed, see, there's no condemnation, there's no judgment. But if you have allowed people to connect to you that have destroyed and taken out and extinguished the God light in you, you need to come on up here. It's time to relight it. It's time to clean house. It's time to kick out every negative thing that has destroyed what God was birthing in you. See, some of us burned bright at one time, but it's something from the world took that brightness and it covered it up or blew it out or doused water on it. All of us have had those moments in our lives where we were so anxious for God. Remember, there's a song that says, take me back to when I first believed.
Yes.
Oh, take me back, God. And you've been wanting to feel that burning again, but somehow it just died off. Well, I invite you to come right now. Let today, I know we're not at Hanukkah, but like I said, and we preaching Christmas next week, to be honest with you. I had to make a decision. I said, well, what am I going to do, God? I mean, they on the same day. We're preaching Christmas next week. So we're not preaching dedication next week. We're preaching dedication this week. This is your chance. This is your time. Let me pray with you. Let me help you ignite God inside of you again. And do what they do. Everything right, but they did everything wrong. God is calling us to get back to the way that He planned it. That we are people that worship Him in spirit and in truth, in authenticity. For real, for real. Not because it's expected, because it's a Sunday morning.
Yes.
Not because it's expected, because everybody else in the sanctuary doing it.
Yes.
But because the Spirit literally is moving and working in your life.
Yes.
That the Spirit is really, really doing something inside of you.
Yes.
That's spirit and truth. That's real. That's real. And you know what else is real? Those of us that are saying to ourselves, well, but I'm broken right now. See, everybody ain't at the same point on this thing. There is no, this is one point, but there's also the broken point. There's the broken point. That's the point of, I don't even know if I can praise right now. I got so much going on and I got to break through in order to get to a praise. See, that's that section too. So you might be right there where you got to get through to a praise. And it's all you can do than to just to wave your hand and just to cry out to God, God help me.
Yeah.
See, everybody ain't at the praising yet.
Come on.
You might be at the pressing. And if you at the pressing, let me encourage you to keep on pressing. Keep on pressing. Keep on pressing. Keep on pressing. God has not forgotten you. He's not forsaken you. Keep on pressing. Keep on digging into it. Keep pressing.
Yes.
The righteous forsaken, nor seed begging bread. God has not forgotten about you. You're on His mind. Who am I that thou art mindful of me? You're on His mind. You're on His mind. He cares about you. Thank you, God. He cares about. He cares what you're going through. He cares about even the small gotta press. Somebody's not at praise yet, and that's all right. Come on, let's press. Come on, let's press it. And there's a story in the Bible, and it's in the book of Job. When Job was going through it, and we all know what Job went through, then God literally took everything from him and even his health. And the Bible says that his friends showed up, and the friends, they took and put on sackcloth and ash, just sat there and rocked and moaned and wailed with them. Nobody even said a word. They just sat there and rocked and moaned and wailed with them for a little while. Because the thing is, sometimes somebody don't need us to fix it. They just need us to be there with them, to rock and moan and wail with them for a little while. So put on the sackcloth and ash. The Bible says that when one of us cries, one of us hurt, we all hurt. But when one of us rejoice, we all rejoice. And sometimes folks just need us to get there with them and rock and moan for a little while. But let me tell you this, I'll rock and moan with you for a little while. But the Bible says weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. So while I get down and rock with you, I'll rock for a little while. But in a little while, when morning comes, we gonna get up from that thing and we gonna rejoice, because God is a good God. God is a good God. God is a good God, and he is faithful, and he will bring you out of whatever you are in. There's a praise on the other side. There's a praise on the other side.
Yes, it is.
Hold on till tomorrow.
Yes, it is.
Hold on till tomorrow. Joy come. Hey, hold on. Hey, joy come. Yay. Joy come in the morning. Yay. Come on, God. Yay. Joy comes in the morning. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, God. Hallelujah. Yes, God. Yes, God. Come on, somebody. Let the Lord do his work. 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 It's all right. It's all right. Let the Lord work. Let the Lord work. It's all right. It's all right. It's all right. It's all right. Don't touch it. Don't touch it. Don't touch it. Let the Lord do his work. Don't touch it. Let the Lord do his work. Let the Lord work. No, let the Lord work. Come on. Yeah. Joy coming to war. Come on, God. Thank you, God. Yay. Thank you, God. Yes. Thank you, God. Yes.
Without a doubt, we know that we have been.